Evergreen Show, taking your business from seed to sapling to towering giant with your hosts, best-selling author and business growth experts, Noah Fleming and Shawn Veltman. This is the only show that gives you proven, pragmatic, and immediately applicable business growth strategies every week in 15 minutes or less. Here's Noah and Shawn.
And we're back. Hello, everybody. I'm starting to feel like a radio DJ here. I'm starting to get that announcer feeling. But this is the Evergreen Show. I'm your host, Noah Fleming, with my co-host, Mr. Shawn Veltman. Shawn, please tell me it's sunny. Where are you? What's going on?
It's at least sunny. It's freezing, but it's sunny. I'm in lovely Calgary, Alberta, home of the mountains, home of the snow, home of the Canadian cold snaps.
Okay, well, listen, we're going to get right into it today. I'm not sure when this podcast is going to come out, but to me, this is something that keeps rearing its ugly head. And we constantly are seeing things in the news about, you know, the latest customer service blunder, the latest fiasco some company has engaged in, whether United is beating the pants off one of their customers, somebody's being dragged off a Southwest plane, you know, Dove puts out an ad that people are a little bit too not very happy with, you know, it's one thing after the other. Volkswagen is scamming customers, Wells Fargo's ripping people off. Shawn, what is this all?
Equifax is losing our data.
Yeah, what's going on in the world? I mean, what are we going to do about this? And let's talk about this from a customer perspective, and then let's apply it to our clients. So let's ask the question first, because there's a few things that are really interesting to me. One, if you're a big company, whether you're a VP of a large organization, whether you're a CEO or somebody else in a company like this, what do you do when this actually happens? Do you call up the PR firms? Do you get the crisis management teams in place? More importantly, what's actually going to happen to you in your relationship with your customers? And then let's look at it from a, you know, a smaller mid-market style business perspective. So if you have these sorts of troubles, what can you do? And then let's tie it back and ask yourselves, I guess let's ask the question, what can we do to avoid these types of things of happening? And I don't know if we can, Shawn, but what do you think is the real culprit here of all these situations we're hearing about?
You know, I think that the culprit is that we've got, you know, a culture of ever decreasing attention spans and ever increasing needs to refill the rage-o-meter. you know, and I think it's both good and bad in some ways. It raises a lot of awareness for things that need awareness. But when it comes to really hating on companies and all of this stuff, luckily for most companies, it doesn't matter. You know, you and I have talked a lot about this, Noah. What happened to United in the month after the most horrific customer service, you know, blunder of all time? How much money did that cost them, Noah?
It cost them absolutely nothing. In fact, within 30 days, more people were flying United than ever before. And so I've blogged about this so many times, right? It was nobody, I'm never flying United again. I'm going to take 3-hour layovers. I'm going to pay extra for my ticket to avoid them. Sure enough, within 30 days, they're a more profitable company, they're more valuable from a stock perspective, and more people are flying them than ever. And then the same thing happens with all of these larger companies. Now, you know, when I write about this, I get all the emails and say, well, you know, you're talking about monopolies and you're talking about industries where there's not much, you know, there's not much competition, so we have to fly United. Well, yeah, you do. But when your rage-o-meter went off, as Shawn said it, you said you weren't going to. And so I think it's interesting to me that, you know, customers in particular these days, and by the way, I am, you know, I am the guy that talks about customer loving your customers and taking care of them and building those evergreen relationships. But what's really interesting to me is that in many cases, you don't need to. What's more important, and this is, I think, the thrust of where I want to take this podcast, and again, you can correct me. What's more important is that you clearly set expectations with your customers in your sales, in your marketing efforts, in your actions, and then meet those expectations all the time. So, you know, one of the things you and I have talked about is we don't expect much more from the airlines. We're used to this type of service. And to be honest, they do a pretty good job. I mean, I haven't had that many issues with airlines through hundreds of flights. But let's get back to the key point here, Shawn. Consistency, expectations, meeting those expectations.
I think that key point really ties into exactly what you just said about the airlines is, you know, in the rage-o-meter culture, in the social media, you know, instant negative stars popping up, it's really easy to single out individual instances where people have screwed up. But most of these companies that are being targeted with this on a daily basis are serving thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions of people. And for the vast, vast majority of those people, they're doing a pretty darn good job. That's they're right. meeting expectations.
So let's bring this back now, because I know we're going to get these comments, we're going to get these questions, we're going to get these concerns from the guy that says, look, you know, I'm a $50 million B2B organization. My team does a pretty good job, but we have really disgruntled customers. We have people that are unhappy with us. What are we doing wrong? Why are we dealing with this? And I think what it comes down to more often than not is this idea of the expectations gap. We've all heard the sayings in marketing, you know, under-promise and over-deliver. What we see time and time again is this over-promising and under-delivery. And that's a huge challenge there. The key, in my opinion, is you need to get really crystal clear about what is it you're telling your customers you're actually going to give them? What is it that they actually expect from you? And then are you constantly meeting those demands? So, you know, we love to talk about this too. Everybody says they provide a wow experience. The best customer service you've ever had in your life is at every business down Main Street. The problem is most of them don't give you that experience. So what do we do here, Shawn?
You know, and that's a really interesting point, is how do you provide a wow experience to everybody when everybody has a different expectation of what wow means, right? As a company, when that's what you're trying to do, you're setting yourself up for failure. Mm. Whereas the flip side of that is to very clearly lay out, both for yourself and maybe even for your customers and clients, everything that you're going to do for them, everything you're going to give them. You know, what does it mean to do business with you? You and I talk about in our latest book, you know, a little thought experiment where imagine you've got a reservation and you're getting flown out if you don't live nearby, and you're going to the French Laundry, one of the best restaurants on the planet. You know, you look forward to it for months in advance. You get there and everything's pretty darn good. But you know, now imagine you have that snooty waiter. Maybe he's having a bad day, and you know, how does that color your experience? And what do you think? And how disappointed are you later on? And you know, compare that to if you go to McDonald's and you get a surly person behind the counter. Probably you're going to be much more disappointed by your French Laundry experience than your McDonald's experience, right? Even though the food was worse, the setting was worse. Yeah, you probably encountered ruder behavior at the McDonald's. And yet, because our expectations were so different between the two, the objective reality doesn't really matter. What matters is the distance, the gap between what our expectation was and what was provided. And so the lesson here, sorry to interrupt, Noah, is, you know, just as you said, what's most important is having a sense of what are you delivering to your customers? Do your customers know what to expect from you? Do they know what the baseline should be? And only when you're meeting that every time can you think about, do I want to go above that? Do I want to create a wow above my baseline?
And I think the one thing that I want to urge our listeners to be careful about, and I see this all the time, is they you know, they attend a conference, they read a book on customer service, and they think, well, now we're going to wow our customers. And so they do something great, and they do something that's wowful and meaningful, but they're inconsistent for everybody else. And so, as you've mentioned to me many times, you know, it's far worse to provide a wow experience to one customer and an inconsistent, lousy experience to multiple others. And so you need to be careful that you're consistent in delivering the same experience or that same type of wow experience to everyone. I think that's far more valuable. And to be honest, quite frankly, that's what the airlines do quite well.
Exactly. You know, there was a really, really interesting set of studies that have been done over the past 20 years or so on dopamine, which, you know, our listeners might recognize as the pleasure chemical in our brains, which is a little bit of a misnomer. But what's fascinating to me is that dopamine isn't released when you get something that makes you happy. Dopamine is released when you're expecting something that makes you happy. And if reality doesn't match up to that expectation, then you get a huge drop off in your dopamine. So it is much worse for you to expect something good and to be disappointed than to get an unexpected benefit. And you know, that's really, you know, that's the neuroscientific explanation of what we've talked about for so many years of create wow experiences only if you're meeting every other expectation first, because otherwise you're in real trouble.
So, you know, I think this is a good spot to get right to the challenge. I think my challenge for this week is always pretty similar when I talk to clients about this or when I talk to prospective customers. Ask yourself all the promises or claims or things that you're saying to customers in your sales efforts, your marketing efforts, and all of your customer-facing initiatives, to be honest. Ask yourself, what are the promises or things that we're saying? And then write down every way that you're actually meeting those expectations. So if you say you provide a wow experience, ask yourself to write down specifically how. If you say,
what does that mean?
What does it mean? What do you do? And then write down every little thing you do to make that happen. And then go through and think about that for all of the things that you're saying. You know, we've talked about this before. It's easy to be really good at marketing. It's easy to psychologically push people down that grease chute and get the first sale. But as I've said in many of my books and many places I speak, getting the first sale is fine. What's far more valuable is, can you get the second or third or fourth sale? And the reality is a lot of companies let the customer down in that first sale. We want to be thinking long-term. And the way you do this is to be consistently good. End of rant, Shawn. What else you got?
I think that's great. I'm going to give the flip side of that exercise, which is to think about, or even better, observe in your company, what are the most common reasons that your customers are being disappointed? What are the most common causes of disappointment? And what can you do to start addressing those?
I like that a lot, Shawn. So you heard us. Those are some great things to think about. You know, and by the way, this isn't an offer to go out and beat up your customers. It will probably impact most of your businesses. But think about these concepts. Think about how you can be consistently great in everything you do instead of trying to, you know, let me rephrase that. Consistently good instead of trying to be haphazardly great in certain areas or at certain times. So, Shawn, if you don't have anything else, I think I'm going to wrap this puppy up because I think this is a great topic. I know we're going to revisit it in the future. Anything else you want to add?
That covers it beautifully for me, so I look forward to our next discussion.
So let me just close this out here. You guys know the routine. Feel free to share this podcast with friends, colleagues, peers, anybody else who you think would enjoy this. If you've seen companies that struggle with this idea of the expectations gap, it's certainly worth forwarding this to them. If you have any questions about this, or if you want to debate or argue or, you know, tell us about your experiences, we'd love to hear them. You can always contact us at noahfleming.com. So with that, we will talk to you next week. Ciao, everybody.
Thanks for listening. Be sure to join us each and every week for another great episode of The Evergreen Show with your hosts, Noah Fleming and Shawn Veltman. If you enjoyed this episode, please rate and review, and we'll catch you next time on The Evergreen Show.